Welcome to Education Today on KPFA 94.1 FM and KPFA.org. We are your hosts, Jaron Epstein and Kitty Kelly Epstein. Today, we will be discussing an exciting educational program using hip-hop, which seeks to democratize English language literacy through music. With the many obstacles young people face, including those added with COVID, it is important to make learning fun and relevant to students and their lives and experiences. Today, we have with us Austin Martin from Rhymes with Reason, a new educational company, which I'm very excited about. Hey, Austin, thank you for being with us today.
Thank you so much for having me.
I wonder if you could start out by giving us a picture of the program and its mission.
Absolutely. So Rhymes with Reason is a web-based app that helps young people learn vocabulary and build literacy skills like inference, context clues, tone, spelling, and more using their favorite music. So for example, the way that it works is that there's like an SAT section and it's called College Prep. And Rhymes with Reason will show how Drake or other popular artists that students listen to on a day-to-day basis use SAT words in their song. So we'll highlight their usage of that word and then also take students through an inference drill where they have to infer what that word means in context and then maybe find other hints within the lyric that that word is used in that point them to the proper meaning of that word. So that's a little bit of how it works. And I actually want to play a quick clip here, if you don't mind, just so that the people can understand how it works. So let me go ahead and do that. Give me 1 second. So here's an example of the artist, a very popular artist with students today, named Ariana Grande. And she uses the word aesthetic in one of her songs. So it's going to show, it shows students how that word is used. So you can hear that. And that's a short summary for how it works. And again, the question about just the mission of Rhymes with Reason is it's really to equip students with these important skills, the vocabulary and the literacy building skills, because those are, and equip them with those skills in a way that feels engaging and is easier to hold on to for more types of students with different, who are coming from all kinds of different backgrounds, because these are essential tools for students to have for success for the rest of their life.
Yeah, definitely. So how did the idea for the program come about?
Yeah, so it really stems from my own experience as a young student. At one point in my life, I wasn't particularly interested in traditional academics. I would say up until high school, I really wasn't, but I was, you know, incredibly invested in music. And particularly lyrics. And unbeknownst to myself, like in a way that I didn't truly realize until I was older, I was actually building a lot of language knowledge by listening to music intently throughout my childhood. And it really started to click for me around high school. And I realized that I could build something that could make things click for more students. when I got to college. So that's kind of how the program came about. Yeah. So that's pretty much it.
That's awesome. Yeah. So I've had a chance to check the program out. Thank you to Austin, which, I was a teacher myself. How I initially found out about the program was, looking for something that had to do with hip hop that I could use with my own students. And I came across a webinar that, Austin had put on, and that's how I initially, heard about it. I'm wondering if for our listeners, for teachers, educators who may be curious, I know you reference the vocabulary is drawn from SAT, but I wonder if you could talk some about, how the curriculum is developed or, kind of what the process is behind that.
Yeah, so the vocabulary there is an SAT section, but there's also a workforce development section. There's a section called Young CEO. There's a civics section. There's a section for second through fourth grade level, fourth through sixth grade level, and seventh through ninth grade level, in addition to the SAT or college prep level. And when I say a section or a level, what I mean is that all the vocabulary that's featured in that section aligns with those grade levels. And all the vocabulary is also used in popular songs. So that's like how the program is structured from a difficulty level perspective. But additionally, really how the program works in its essence is, as I kind of showed earlier, when you heard the audio, the student's objective is the first thing that their main objective is to learn of the meaning of a vocabulary term or get introduced to a vocabulary term and the reference point or the context around that vocabulary term is a popular song lyric. So they hear that term used in the song, they read the lyric, and then they go through different drills after they're introduced to that term that relate to inference, context, clues, spelling, tone, and more. But the idea is that vocabulary is aligned with a grade level or aligned with a standardized test or another subject area is that's used in a song is the learning hook that kind of unlocks these other opportunities for learning that are more skill-based and relate to a student's kind of larger literacy building process.
Right. Man, that's awesome. So as a teacher myself, I really see a lot of possibilities for how it can be used. And I can imagine that schools, are finding innovative ways to put it to use. Can you tell us what are some of the applications that you're seeing with the program in schools?
Yeah, absolutely. One of the main applications is it's used as a reading in reading intervention blocks. So students go through our modules, they go through our units and modules during reading intervention block time. So for students potentially that are underperforming in reading, they go on the Rhymes with Reason platform and go through our drills to practice, to learn new words and get introduced to these different skills that relate to their literacy via our model. Additionally, a teacher can pull different terms from our database that might match with a thematic exploration that they're otherwise doing in their curriculum. So, for example, if a teacher is teaching Romeo and Juliet, they might be able, which is, of course, Shakespearean literature, they might be able to pull vocabulary from our database that relates to romance, but is from popular artists. So Rihanna, Drake, J. Cole, might be using words that talk about their romantic, relationships or whatever that's referenced in their songs. And again, the idea is to make these things really click for students. So that theme, just through the Shakespearean lens, you know, might seem outdated for some students or might not be as easy to connect with as it is through the voice of, you know, the artists of this generation, right? So it just bridges that gap. So that's another way that educators are using it.
Man, that's great. So for our listeners, you're listening to Education Today, 94.1 KPFA. We're currently speaking with Austin Martin, the creator of Rhymes with Reason. Can you talk some about results? You know, the results from the, you know, the program, and maybe kind of, you know, address as a teacher, I find that, you know, for a lot of students that the, you know, maybe you're showing up to school, but getting the results or the, you know, maybe the grades that you want to get is not always the, you know, is not always the best outcome. But, you know, just wondering what you can talk about results and maybe successes that students are finding with using Rhymes with Reason.
Yeah, absolutely. Before I get into like all of the kind of quantitative results, the number one result that we see, you know, repeatedly is that this program is uniquely kind of the consensus favorite program for a lot of students in school where it's being used. So we hear all the time from teachers, instructors, administrators, that this is like one of the few programs that students repeatedly ask to do. You know, students have a lot of programs that they utilize in school, and this is one that they really like ask for and are like, hey, we want Rhymes with Reason time, because they get to listen to artists that they like and it really connects with them in that way. So that's like one of our favorite kind of anecdotal results that we get repeatedly. Additionally, we've seen an SAT score at a middle school, a mean SAT score at a middle school in Flint, Michigan, on the reading section increase by 60 points, not 60%, 60 points on the reading section. And then in a fifth grade cohort in San Diego, California, 50% of the fifth grade cohort grew on the Renaissance reading exam at a pace that's comparable to that's comparable to 2 months in a that's comparable to 4 to 8 months, but in just a 2 month span. So they like grew, they kind of doubled the growth in that amount of time in San Diego in a fifth grade cohort. So yeah, I think again, the key piece is just students being highly engaged and kind of easing the uphill climb, that's inherent in learning words and building reading skills, because it's interesting for the student.
Yeah, definitely. So just as a follow-up to that, I'm wondering if, you know, if this was, you know, intentional or, you know, I mean, it's web-based, so, you know, their students are using technology, but, you know, wondering about if there's any, you know, connections to, you know, to STEM or, you know, or if you have any thoughts about that and if this is, like, helping to, you know, maybe give students some, you know, potential or, you know, wanting to get more involved in the, you know, STEM, which, you know, also includes arts and, you know, so I was just wondering about.
Definitely. Certainly on the art side, you know, another way you asked earlier about ways that this is used, this may not be as much of like a way that's used in the traditional classroom, but Rhymes with Reason is often used as a tool for young people to learn words and skills that directly connect to their ability to rap and write poetry. There, you know, there's activities that people do kind of in an after school setting where they turn what they learn in Rhymes with Reason into like a toolbox for rap writing and poetry writing. Obviously, words are like, in a sense, like essential element of that, which is kind of the whole premise of the program. But students turn that into their own creation. And then also, you know, it's interesting. So we have the workforce development module and then the entrepreneurship and financial literacy module where young people learn terms that connect to those topics. Those are kind of tangentially related to STEM. And then, yeah, I mean, one thing too that is just undeniable is like literacy is important in every subject. So when you're doing math and you have word problems, you need to understand what the word problems are asking you to do. So having a, you know, a vast vocabulary, and you know, practicing inference skills, is key in even navigating the math subjects as well. So it has implications in all of those areas.
Yeah, definitely. Another thing which, you know, I've seen as a, you know, teacher myself with, you know, one of the things with, you know, COVID, students coming back to school, you know, I think attention is already kind of been an issue. And, you know, with students being on their phone all the time, it's kind of hard to keep their, you know, attention. But, you know, I definitely can see the students being interested in, you know, in using rhymes with reason and, you know, wondering if there's been any, you know, positive results, you know, with that's, you know, related to that in students' achievement.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I think just to your point, with COVID, there's already a huge challenge that we face in today's day and age with just all the social media and all these things that are capturing student attention everywhere, and how short the attention span has gotten and all of those things. And then on top of that now, like you said, COVID came and put students, you know, a couple grade levels behind in terms of development as well. So it's like we have to work twice as hard to have solutions that, you know, make students really lean into learning, because we need accelerated, you know, double effort in terms of a push to get students to learn, to motivate them to learn, for them to make up for double the distance that they've kind of lost. So yeah, we're leaning into where students' attention is already in many respects, which is their music and the music that they consume, and incorporating that into the learning rather than asking them to separate, you know, what they already do in terms of attention and engagement.
Right, definitely. I feel like you've kind of have already you know, kind of answered this, but just to kind of ask, you know, directly, why is it important for, you know, learning to be infused with hip hop?
I would say that it's important because with hip hop specifically, hip hop is, it's the most popular genre of music in the world at this point in our history. And, you know, it's the most popular genre of music in the world for, and just in general, but for Gen Z, it's even more popular than it is for adults. And this is the language and culture that Gen Z is consuming, you know, at an extremely high rate. So again, the idea is to meet students where they are and to utilize the things where student attention already is, and in some ways leverage that for positive learn to positively affect their learning. So that, you know, that's why.
Definitely. How do you envision and see Rhymes with Reason continuing to grow?
Yeah, in many different ways. I think that we want to make inroads in as many schools and after school programs as we can across the United States, particularly in urban metropolitan cities, and in areas that have, going back to the point we were talking about earlier with kind of the performance gaps that have been caused by the pandemic. We really want to launch this program in areas that have been deeply affected in terms of reading performance post-pandemic. So there are specific cities, you know, I'll just name a few, like Memphis, Tennessee, Cleveland, Ohio, many more, that where middle schoolers have particularly have really declined in their reading performance. Since the pandemic, and we want to launch our program in these cities to make a big difference. And yeah, additionally, I think Rhymes with Reason, ultimately, we want to integrate it into more subjects. You mentioned STEM earlier, math, science, and other subjects. And then ultimately, yeah, this becomes something that is kind of like when Gen Zers are adults, they think back to like, what was, you know, the most exciting, what was the program that I liked doing the most when I was in school? And I want them to think Rhymes with Reason. So, and then another answer is like, we want to help a million students.
That's right. Well, I'm with you, man. I'm going for a million students for Rhymes with Reason, and I'm excited to bring it to my own school and to use it with my own students. You know, before we close out, wondering if people are interested in getting more information about Rhymes with Reason, how can they get more info, get in touch with you, and any final thoughts that you'd like to share?
Definitely. To get in touch, please check out our website at www.rhymeswithreason.com. You can email us on our website. You can sign up for a free trial. You can enter in information if you want to learn more. And we do demos. Additionally, follow us on Instagram at Rhymes with Reason. And yeah, most of our socials are just titled Rhymes with Reason. And yeah, in terms of final thoughts, just really thankful for the opportunity to be on here, and it's always great to be on platforms that are mutually interested in envisioning a positive collective future where we're approaching education in creative and innovative ways for Generation Z. So just really thankful for this opportunity to be here, and would love to hear from the audience.
Definitely. Well, thank you so much, Austin, for being with us today. Thank you for all the work that you're doing and making time to be with us.
Of course. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Austin. Take care.
So this was a fantastic presentation, and I think as most of our listeners know, both Jaron and I are involved in education. Jaron teaches himself and has a network of other teachers that he works with, and I do teacher education. And so I would recommend this to a lot of people, because the arguments that Austin's making for why it's important are very compelling. And we tend to try to tell kids, well, you should do this and you should do that. And maybe the better approach is to say, what should we do that will make the students more engaged in their education? Because just the way we've always done things doesn't necessarily mean that they're the best way. So I hope people will check out the program. He's really has some wonderful answers for why it's important. We wanted to bring you a couple pieces of education news before we close today. One that people may have heard is that the Los Angeles Teachers Union won a total of something like 30% in raises over several year period during their 3-day strike. So this is a great victory for teachers across the country. And another potential victory is the fact that Bernie Sanders has introduced a law. We don't know what'll happen with it, but we hope it gets a lot of support from KPFA listeners and other people. The law would mandate that teachers across the country make a minimum salary of $60,000 a year. And that is way above what lots of teachers across the country make. In California, it would be a raise for quite a lot of teachers. In California, teachers are better paid than they are in a lot of other states in the country. So this is a really exciting possibility. And I think the militancy of teachers right now may have some impact on whether it does well or not. So hope our listeners will keep track of that. The other event from another country, which I think people should know about, is that we've talked a lot on this program about some of the issues affecting education in other countries. Angela Davis has spent a lot of time in France, and a lot of people like her there for her activism and her involvement. And a school near Paris was named for her. So it's called the Angela Davis School, and it's in Saint-Denis, which is a kind of famous suburb with many Black and Muslim and Arab students attending and living in that community. Well, now the right-wing government, which we've talked about a bit here, which is right-wing both in their approach to pensions for the population of France and also very anti-Muslim in the kind of laws that they make. So now the right-wing portion of the government has said that they will not accept the name, and it cannot be named any longer for Angela Davis because she has criticized the French government for its discrimination against Muslim women who wear the hijab. So women who wear the headscarf have faced a lot of discrimination. Angela Davis has criticized the government for that very legitimately, and I think I have a lot of respect for her doing that because a lot of Americans haven't paid attention to it. And so the government head of that region has said that the school cannot bear her name because she has made this criticism of the French government. And so they have proposed instead the ridiculous idea of naming it for Rosa Parks. I think Ms. Parks would definitely oppose that move, and maybe they like her better because she's not still alive to criticize the government. So we'll be keeping our eye on a number of these different issues with you, and we're really happy that we could spend some time with you today. You've been listening to Education Today on KPFA 94.1 FM, and we're your hosts, Jaron Epstein and Kitty Kelly Epstein. We join you every Wednesday at 2:30 p.m. and have a good week. Bye-bye.
KPFA is on social media. Follow us on your favorite platforms for news headlines, live stream events, show info, and more. That's at KPFA 94.1 on Facebook and at KPFA Radio on Twitter, Instagram, YouTube, and TikTok.
You're listening to 94.1 KPFA and 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, 97.5 K248BR in Santa Cruz, 94.3 K23FZ in Monterey, and online worldwide at kpfa.org.